Hi, this is Philip Ador, founder of NCLEX RN 45 Day Challenge. In this video, I'm going to be talking about Acute Respiratory Distress Syndrome, or ARDS. ARDS is a respiratory failure that occurs when the capillary membrane that surrounds the alveoli sacs starts to leak fluid. And whenever it leaks fluid, fluid will actually enter into this sac. Well, we know that's a problem, because why? Let's review our anatomy and physiology of the lungs. So what part of the lungs is really the functional unit? It's the alveoli sac. This is where the gas exchange occurs. So if we took a sac and we blew up one and we look at it, this is sort of similar what it would look like. Okay? So here on this side, overlaying those sacs were like capillaries. And those capillaries are bringing the blood from the heart. Because all of the blood goes to the heart, must pass through the lungs to get oxygenated. So you have one coming from the pulmonary arteries, and the blood coming from the pulmonary artery is like to use that blood the body just used as came back to the heart to get reoxygenated and to rid itself off of carbon dioxide. So here it comes down through the pulmonary artery, and the oxygen that this person just breathed in is going to cross over into that capillaries, and he's going to oxygenate the blood. Now, what's going to leave the blood is that build up that carbon dioxide. It's going to cross over into that in the alveoli sac. And carbon dioxide is going to be exhaled by that person. So you have this beautiful intake of oxygen and outtake of carbon dioxide. And then the blood is going to go back through the pulmonary vein. It's going to be pumped by the heart, and it's going to go through the body and replenish your organs, your brains, your kidneys, and everything you need to function. But we have a problem with ARDS. What's happening is that these capillary membranes isn't working correctly. It's starting to leak fluid from the capillary bed. So fluid's starting to leak where it shouldn't go, and it can collect in this sac. So you're going to have a decrease in gas exchange. And what's going to happen is that the sac will become so filled with fluid, you're going to have a problem with the sac being able to stay open. So it's going to collapse, and we don't want our alveoli sacs to collapse. Because when that happens, when a person tries to take in air with an oxygen in it, it's not going to work because the sac is collapsed. It's not working. So you're going to get a decrease in oxygen in the blood. The fancy term is hypoxemia. So you have a low oxygen in the blood. And what's going to do to your organs, your brains, your kidneys, your gut, everything we need to live, work without oxygen in it. So organs are going to suffer, and the patient can die. So the patient, when they really have a severe ARDS, they're going to need the respiratory assistance of some kind. And usually, it's like a mechanical ventilation with PEEP, or positive and expiratory pressure. What's that going to do? Well, that PEEP, as you're going to learn later in your nursing interventions, is going to help open the sacs that have collapsed, which is going to improve our gas exchange and help the patient. So first, let's talk about some quick facts about ARDS. Okay, the onset is fast. This happens suddenly, and usually when you're going to say this condition is in the patients who are really aren't already hospitalized or there for something else. Let's say a severe burn or sepsis, which is one of the most common causes of ARDS. So they're hospitalized with another condition, and they develop this. So as a nurse, you've really got to listen to those respiratory sounds. Look at your patient's respiratory system. And what happens is that usually develops due to some systematic inflammations that's occurring in that body. So we know that all the blood in her body has to go through the lungs to get oxygenated. And we just learned that. So if you have some type of complications going in that body, that's making that immune system send all those inflammatory cells. And so the blood that's going through the body normally, eventually, when it comes to the heart, in this area for this gas exchange to happen. So we can go back and do it. So, well, if those inflammatory cells are here in this blood, what it's going to do is it can damage the capillary membrane, and it causes it to leak fluid. So you can have a direct injury that causes ARDS, or you can have indirect, which we're going to cover those here in a moment. Now, the mortality rate with ARDS is relatively high. So patients who have this is very serious conditions. They're treated in the intensive care unit. Now, let's talk about what causes the capillary membrane that surrounds the alveolar sacs to leak. And then we'll talk about the pathophysiology and the phases of ARDS. Okay? So any event that leads to major systemic inflammation in the body can cause this condition. And this is usually from indirect sources. So the sources is not in the lungs. It's somewhere else through the body. And what happens is that the immune system with the inflammatory cells is producing a lot of those. And of course, lowering the blood. So the blood is passing through the lungs. Because we learned that it has to do that they can damage the capillary membrane, causing leakage of fluid. So some conditions that can cause that are sepsis. And remember, sepsis was the most common cause of ARDS, and if the patient's substance is being caused by a gram-negative bacteria. The patient has a very poor prognosis because it's going to be really hard to treat. In addition, it's burns. Can cause severe burns throughout the body. You have a major inflammation going on with that. In addition, it's blood transfusions, where they have multiple transfusions. Inflammations of the pancreas or pancreatitis hints that inflammation is going on with the pancreas and drug overdose. Now, another way a person can develop ARDS is through direct causes. So the sources is what? Our lungs. It's coming from the lungs and it has been directly damaged at capillary membrane. And what can cause this is like pneumonia. Patients get pneumonia and those long-term can damage that membrane. Aspirations. A lot of patients who have difficulty swallowing, they can aspirate food. Gastric secretions, which we know that. What's the role of it? It digests. So if it gets into our delicate lungs, it can definitely damage the capillary membranes. Now, inhaling any toxic substances like smoke, powders, anything like that, that gets in there damage the membrane. Now, let's talk about the pathophysiology of ARDS. How does it happen? Now, as I go through these phases, this is the absolute worst case scenario. Not all patients. We even go through these phases. Some patients recover faster than others. But if they do hit this last phase, their prognosis is very poor and they're going to have a lot of lung damage. So there's three phases and we're going to talk about that. Exudative, then the proliferative, then the fibrotic. First, we will talk about the exudative phase. Okay? This happens about 24 hours after injury. And remember, it can be direct or indirect. Regardless, there's going to be damage to that capillary membrane. So when you have a damage to that membrane, fluid is going to start to leak into the sac. And that fluid is protein rich. Now, what's one thing we have been talking about with protein? Protein regulates water, that oncotic pressure. So if you have this fluid that's leaking with water, protein regulates water, that oncotic pressure. So if you have this fluid that's leaking with water, protein is going to draw more water to it, which is not good. So at first, this fluid is going to enter into the interstitium, which is like that space that is in between the sac and that capillary. So whenever you're listening to the long sounds in the early part of this, they may sound normal or a little bit diminished. You're not going to start hearing a normal one when it feels that fluid starts going into that alveolar sac. So that's where it's going to go after the interstitium. And that's where this patient is going to have pulmonary edema. So you can hear those crackles with that. Now, one thing with acute respiratory distress syndrome is that the physician has to determine, is this an ARDS or is this a heart-related, like heart failure? While we're getting a pulmonary edema, we're going to talk about it in our nursing interventions, but they will probably look at it in the pulmonary artery wedge pressure. And whatever that reading is can help us know, is this an ARDS? In addition from everything that's going on, there's cells in the air that produces surfactant and they're going to become overwhelmed and become damaged. So we're going to have decreased amount of surfactant being produced. Now, what does surfactant do? It helps decrease the surface tension. So in other words, it helps the sac to stay stable. So what's going to happen, you have decreased amount of surfactant equals an unstable alveolar sac that's going to a class. And they're going to develop a condition that's called atelectasis. So with atelectasis, the person's not going to be able to move that oxygen in. Because the sac is collapsed, fewer oxygen levels is going to fall, hypoxemia. Now, to make things even worse, if it can get any worse, something's going to develop that is made up of dead cells and proteins called Hyaline membrane. And this membrane is going to affect how the lungs work. It's going to make the lungs less elastic, so the lungs are going to be stiff. And you're going to have decreased lung compliance. So really, how one can stretch and whenever the person breathes in and out. So what's going to happen, you're going to have what we call the VQ mismatch of ventilation and perfusion mismatch, where the ventilation's ability to ventilate isn't going to match the body's ability to perfuse. So with all this going on, the fluid buildup on the alveoli sacs, the decreased surfactant that the hyaline membranes that's developing, it's all going to lead to the alveolar sacs collapsing. It's not going to work. Also, you're going to see a decrease in the lung compliance, which is going to throw us into the VQ mismatch. And whenever you're looking at your patients as a nurse, because all of this path that's going on, there is a hallmark signs and symptoms that you want to remember, and it's called refractory hypoxemia. So as the nurse, you can give them high amounts of oxygen, concentrations of oxygen is not going to increase their oxygen level. And the reason is because what's going on, our lungs are getting stiff and our sacs are collapsed. That oxygen cannot slow down through that sac to go into that capillary and replenish the body. So there's a way you can get that oxygen back up because of what's going on. So when you look at the ABGs, where are you going to see? Well, in that very early stages, in order for the low body to try to compensate, it has low oxygen. So what do you think in your body wants to do whenever it has a low oxygen? I want to increase your breathing, so you're going to have an increased respiration rate. But as we have just learned, it's not going to help us, so we're still going to have a low oxygen level, so we're breathing hard. With breathing hard well, oxygen can get in, but carbon dioxide is still crossing over. So as we're breathing out, that fast breathing, where we're going to be blowing off carbon dioxide. So our carbon dioxide level will drop and blood pH level will increase. So we're going to enter into respiratory alkalosis at first. Now as the patient progresses to those different phases, we have the continued development of this Hyaline membrane, and it's going to make it even more hard to carbon dioxide to cross over. We're going to start actually increasing it in our carbon dioxide levels. Along with the patient's respiratory muscles are just going to get wore out. So you're going to see an increase in carbon dioxide, so then they can enter into respiratory acidosis later on. And just like the word proliferative, talk about growing and reproducing, that's what's happening in this phase. The body is trying to repair structures. So you have these cells that are being reproduced quickly. To do this, and you're going to have the resorptions of that fluid that was in that sac. But here's the thing, it's not going to be reproduced and restructures like it should be. What's going to happen is that this lung tissue that's being created is going to be very dense and fibrous. So you're going to have even more decreased lung compliance, and that hypoxemia is going to get worse. So after that phase, about 3 weeks after the injury, some patients enter into the fibrotic phase. And this is where you have the fibrosis of the lung tissue. Doesn't work right, and pretty much that patient can have is just dead space in the lungs. That just doesn't work. You don't have the gas exchange, so patients who do enter into this fibrotic phase are going to have a major lung damage, and their prognosis is very poor. And like I said at the beginning, not all patients will enter into this. This is like the worst case scenario.